I'm Sean Martin, president and founder of Donek Snowboards. In this video, I'm going to explain how the different side cut shapes that we produce can affect your riding. In order to ensure that everyone watching is on the same page, I'm going to start with some basic concepts and then progress through some demonstrations intended to provide background information necessary to the discussions. Finally, I'll show you how the different side cut shapes that we offer can affect the shape and dynamics of the turn produced by a snowboard. Almost anybody who's purchased a snowboard has taken a look down the side of the board like this, bent it like that, and there's a good reason for that. Some of you may or may not know what it is, but that reason is because these two things define very, very key features in the snowboard. The combination of curvature on the side of the board and the degree to which it bends define the ease or lack of ease with which you can carve a turn. Let me demonstrate. Okay, so if you're standing on your board, you're flattening it out, bending it a little bit, and when we make a turn, we tip the board up on edge. Now, if we tip it a little bit, we can see a curvature created with the contact point between the edge and the snow or the surface we're riding on. And as long as we use the correct technique, the board is going to travel right along the path generated by the edge. So the steeper we angle the board, you can see the curvature keeps getting tighter and tighter. So we get more and more curvature, and therefore we carve a tighter turn. So the more we angle that board, the more force we put on that board, the tighter the turn that the board creates. Okay, I've moved outside because I want to be able to demonstrate some basic physics principles. And I don't have enough room in the studio there. So what we're going to look at is the forces that a snowboarder sees while he's riding. The way we're going to do that is I've got a simple little contraption here. This is just a frame that holds my GoPro camera. And then what we've got is a weight here suspended by a rubber band. So what you're going to see is that rubber band stretching and coming up. My little device going around in circles here, and you'll be able to see in the side frame sort of what's happening. Now what I'm going to do to begin with is I'm going to speed things up and go even faster, and you're going to see that that rubber band really stretches. Alright, so now what I'm going to do is slow things down a little bit, not too much, and what's going to happen is I'm going to tighten my radius by pulling on my string without slowing down the speed. All right, so let's do that again. So if I maintain the same speed, but shorten the radius that I'm turning in, you're gonna see that that rubber band stretches a little bit more and we see a greater centrifugal force. And both of these things are key. Your speed, the faster you go, the greater the centrifugal force you see. The tighter the radius you go, the greater the centrifugal force you experience. Now let's look at a couple other things. One of the primary problems with the last demonstration is that when we're snowboarding, we're not on a horizontal plane. We're actually on an inclined plane. So what we're going to look at next is what happens to the forces as we traverse through our turn on an inclined plane. Let's see if I can get this going. And you can see that I'm running on an inclined plane here. And what you're going to see here is that the forces are greater at the bottom of the turn than at the top of the turn. This is a really, really key element to what happens in a snowboard. We go through a turn. Okay, I'm back here in the studio and I've got my little pretend snowboarding slope set up that we can draw on and look at some of the things we've learned and see what the results are. Now, the first thing I want to talk about though is how most manufacturers describe the side cut of their board. You're going to find that most of the time, if you look at the specs of a snowboard, you're going to find that they list a radius for this curve. Now, if you don't know what that means, it's essentially just this curve is a section of a circle. So pop up a little graphic, but if you were to continue this curve indefinitely, it would actually come back and hit the other end of the snowboard and be a circular shape. That being said, let's return to what we've been observing and have a look at what's happening through a turn. One of the most important things we've observed is that as our speed increases while we're going through a turn, the centrifugal force, or the force we're applying to the snowboard, increases as well. So faster speed means greater centrifugal force. The other thing that's important is a smaller turn or a tighter turning radius means greater centrifugal force. The other thing we've observed is at the top of our turn, if this is our turn, up at the top we have a relatively small centrifugal force, and at the bottom we have a relatively large centrifugal force. And in between, well, it's going to be a little bit bigger. It's actually building, okay? This is because of a number of factors. If you recall, we said greater speed means a greater centrifugal force. Well, up here, we're going relatively slowly, but we've come down a hill here, and our speed has increased and increased and increased. Therefore, our centrifugal force down at the bottom is increasing. What else is happening? Well, we showed earlier that when you tilt the board at a steeper angle, the board bends more and our turn gets tighter. Well, because our centrifugal force, or our force being applied to the board, has increased, we have to lean into the turn more, which means we're tipping the board more on angle. Which means what? We're tightening the radius. So our turn is getting a smaller radius down the bottom than it was up top, a very big radius, okay? Because we've tipped the board further over on edge, our forces have combined and helped us make an even tighter turn. There's one other factor here that explains what's going on. We've got the force of gravity pulling us down the hill. Up here at the top of the turn, the force of gravity is fighting or detracting from our centrifugal force, so our centrifugal force is small. Over here in the middle of our turn, it's not having an effect other than to pull us down the slope and make us go faster. Down here at the bottom, in addition to this increased speed, increased angle, reduced turning radius, we've also got the force of gravity pushing on the board as well, making us bend it even more. So all of these factors combine to result in a low force, a medium force, and a very large force on the board, which means a very large turning radius up here, a medium turning radius down here, and a very tight turning radius down here. So we can fairly easily represent what that turn shape actually looks like. It's big at the top, tighter, 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 getting very, very small towards the bottom. So this is what happens when we use a circular radius on the side of the board, because nothing is changing with respect to the shape of the board, and all of these forces are getting bigger and bigger towards the bottom. Now, a lot of free carvers really like this turn shape. They like it because what happens is, as they go through the turn, as they progress, the board is bending a little and more and more and more until they get to the end of the turn where the board is bent a huge amount, and then boom, they release all that energy and use the board like a springboard to launch them through the air into the next turn. So if that's the type of turn you like to make, well then a single radius side cut is really possibly what you want. We can do similar things with some of the other side cut shapes, but it will generate this type of turn shape and that type of building of energy towards the end of the turn, and then the ability to release all that energy and cause the board to slingshot you into the air, and then you can start your next turn. Well, the next question becomes, what happens if this isn't right for me? Well, if you look at a racer, this isn't right at all. In fact, a racer wants a turn shaped completely opposite from what we just saw. They want a turn that's tight at the top and longer and longer at the bottom. Why? Because if there's a gate, let's say right here, they want to make a rapid direction change at the top of their turn and accelerate to the turn or to the next gate that's down here somewhere. So a rapid direction change and an acceleration is what they want to create. Well, question becomes, how can we create something like that with a different side cut shape or through board engineering? Well, we have to look at one other factor that's occurring in your turn, and that is, where's your weight as the turn progresses? So if you look at a typical snowboarder, when they start their turn up at the top, the forces that are going to generate the centrifugal force needed to generate a carve turn aren't there. They've got to create them themselves. So what they do is they tend to lunge into the front of the board or distribute or displace their center of mass towards the front of the board, so that instead of bending the entire board now, they're bending just a portion of it. And by doing so, they can initiate a turn and begin that carved turn. And as their turn progresses, your weight typically slowly through the turn shifts towards the tail of the board. So what we can do is vary the radius of the side cut from the tip of the board to the tail. And we do that very simply with the same technique I just drew that curve. It's what we call a continuously variable side cut radius. And it gives a very smooth, continuously variable side cut radius and the ability to very smoothly and effectively adjust your turn shape depending upon where your weight is on the board. There are a few companies using variable side cut radiuses these days. It's frequently referred to as VSR. And what they'll do is they'll use a combination of radii. So they might start with, they might start with one radius here and then progress to a second radius towards the tail of the board. And you can see that there's a marked change, or a very visible change in the shape of the curve there. So what can be done is you can use more than one radius. So you might go to three. So you've got your first radius and then a transition radius and then your big radius down in the other end. So that smooths things out a little bit. What we do at Donek is we use something we refer to as a continuously variable side cut radius. And that involves a radius that changes continuously down the length of the side cut. So you've got a very even transition from one radius to the other over the entire length, giving you a tremendous amount of variability in your turn shape.